tardes y bienvenidos. Good afternoon and welcome. Como director de esta escuela es un placer y un honor recibirles a ustedes hoy con motivo de la conferencia y última sesión de clausura del posgrado de tecnología de motocicleta. Nuestra escuela, la Escuela Técnica Superior de Ingeniería Industrial de Barcelona, centro de la Universidad Politécnica de Cataluña, es una de las escuelas más antiguas de ingeniería industrial más antiguas junto con la de Madrid de España. Tenemos ya 160 años de existencia, de historia, y durante toda nuestra historia, durante toda nuestra evolución, siempre hemos procurado, como misión que tenemos, el estar al frente del desarrollo de la industria. Y en el área de Cataluña, una de las industrias con más tradición es la del sector de la automoción. Por tanto, hemos estado acompañando el nacimiento y evolución de la industria de la automoción y también del sector de la motocicleta desde sus inicios. Y especialmente en los últimos tiempos nos hemos preocupado en intentar ser un centro universitario de referencia en el ámbito de la automoción. Solo un poco a título de formación para los que no están tan familiarizados con nuestra escuela, con la universidad. Tenemos dos cátedras especiales, una cátedra SEAT en diseño e innovación en automóvil sostenible y una cátedra IDIADA AP+ en seguridad en automóvil. Tenemos un centro de innovación y coordinación de tecnologías de automoción. Impartimos ya en estos momentos un diploma en automoción, en paralelo a la titulación de ingeniero industrial. Tenemos un equipo en nuestra escuela participando en la competición Fórmula Student desde hace 4 años. Hemos participado ya en 4 ediciones y estamos preparando el vehículo de la 5ª edición para nosotros. Hemos participado una vez y estamos apuntados a la 2ª edición del Moto Student, que se celebra en Alcañiz. Y casi como primicia puedo decir que en septiembre del año que viene, en septiembre del 2012, ponemos en marcha un máster en Ingeniería de Automoción, un máster universitario. Por tanto, nuestra vocación es especialmente el sector de la automoción, que entendemos que tanto industrial, económica como socialmente tiene importancia en Cataluña, pues estar al servicio de la formación y de la promoción en todo aquello que podemos. Decirles que es una verdadera alegría, un verdadero placer poder acoger hoy esta conferencia aquí. Se han hecho muchas actividades relacionadas especialmente con SPA, ya que la escuela es también sede de SPA Cataluña, relacionadas con la automoción, pero pocas con la motocicleta. Por tanto, este es un sector especialmente importante también y por tanto es un auténtico placer. Decirles además que yo personalmente, como motociclista y apasionado de motocicleta, pues es un auténtico placer poder tener hoy al señor Toni Foale, que es experto bien conocido de todos a nivel mundial en diseño de chasis y suspensiones en motocicletas. Por tanto, seguro que va a ser una conferencia atractiva e interesante para todos. Nada más, y paso la palabra a Rafael Bornat, señor Rafael Bornat, que es presidente de SPA Cataluña.
Sí, gracias, Francesc. Buenas tardes y bienvenidos a esta sesión. Yo en primer lugar tengo que felicitar a ATP y a los organizadores y profesores de este posgrado de Mototec, que realmente es una actividad, es una iniciativa encomiable, porque la motocicleta, sobre todo en Cataluña, tiene una larga tradición industrial y tecnológica. Ha sido cuna de muchísimas marcas de gran relieve mundial, y realmente hay un pozo de tradición y de conocimiento que realmente es importantísimo que le volvamos a dar impulso y volvamos a diseñar, desarrollar y fabricar motocicletas con las tecnologías más actuales. Por eso este posgrado de formación es realmente muy oportuno, y desde la Sociedad de Técnicos de Automoción, que somos una sociedad de implantación estatal y con delegaciones en diversas comunidades, como ha dicho Francesc, que no lo ha dicho, pero lo digo yo, es el presidente de SPA Cataluña, con sede en esta escuela, que es donde había estado anteriormente SPA, para nosotros es una satisfacción que hoy podamos tener esta gran acogida a esta sesión por una razón, y lo diré, antes se lo comentaba anteriormente a Josep, que hemos intentado desde SIDEA no centrarnos solamente en las más de dos ruedas, es decir, en las cuatro y más, sino que realmente hemos intentado que nuestra organización, que estamos organizados por secciones técnicas, la sección técnica de motocicletas desarrollase más encuentros de este tipo, encuentros como el de hoy se multipliquen. Nosotros como SIDEA estamos a la disposición de cuantas personas y entidades de hecho quieran dar relevancia al sector y a la tecnología de la motocicleta, y por eso esta satisfacción. Como SIDEA somos una sociedad sin ánimo de lucro con alrededor de 800 socios entre empresas y personas individuos. Nosotros publicamos nuestra propia revista de tecnología de automóvil con una periodicidad bimensual que repartimos como parte de la cuota de inscripción de socio, y por tanto es en este país en donde impulsar la tecnología, dicho honestamente, no es tan fácil, es importante que yo desde aquí les anime a asociarse a SIDEA, porque cuando realmente más seamos, más posibilidades tendremos y más fuertes seremos a la hora de tirar adelante proyectos como este. Así pues, yo le quiero también dar las gracias al conferenciante, al señor Toni Fuale, porque estaba hablando con él ahora hace poco, y realmente pues es también una satisfacción que podamos hablar de dinámica de motocicletas. Es decir, hemos organizado como SIDEA ya diversos cursos de dinámica de vehículos automóviles, de cuatro ruedas, la típica materia, la típica disciplina de mecánica, pero realmente es la primera vez que se ha hablado en la clase anterior, y hoy supongo que en esta conferencia sobre una vida dedicada al diseño de motocicletas, pues también saldrá el tema, y creo que es importante que no solamente la dinámica, sino la arquitectura, el diseño, la fabricación, la utilización, la competición y demás de las... Nada más, gracias por la asistencia y cedo la palabra a Josep. Molt bé, Josep.
La palabra a José Nieves, gerente de ATP. Primero de todo, agradeceros a todos esta gran aceptación que ha tenido la conferencia, que para nosotros ha sido una gran sorpresa, no porque el conferenciante, evidentemente, sino porque a veces nos cuesta encontrar una aceptación tan grande en el sector de las dos ruedas, del cual somos una empresa bastante especializada en el mismo, aunque para nosotros el sector al que nos dirigimos es la automoción en general. Os voy a explicar en cuatro diapositivas y muy rápidamente qué es ATP, para que nos conozcáis, porque a pesar de que hay mucha gente que nos conoce, hay mucha gente que no nos conoce, y veáis un poco que seguro que sobre todo si estáis interesados en el conocimiento en el mundo de la motocicleta, pues desde ATP siempre estamos lanzando formación a nivel profesional para este sector o para el sector de la automoción. ATP es una empresa que, como nosotros decimos, es un partner en la industria de la automoción, y podemos ayudar a la industria de la automoción en diversas áreas, y desde ATP cogemos el proyecto que nos pasa en cualquiera de estas áreas y lo desarrollamos a gusto o a medida del cliente, ¿no? Tenemos tres áreas de trabajo, que serían el área de desarrollo, en la cual tenemos unas instalaciones adecuadas y acordes para desarrollar vehículos, especialmente estamos centrados en el mundo de la motocicleta. Tenemos una segunda área, que sería la de formación, que es la que nos trae hoy aquí a todos. El hecho de haber desarrollado el posgrado nos ha dado un estatus, puede ser superior al que tenemos hasta ahora, en cuanto a nivel de formación, y tenemos otro área que es la de competición, en la cual como más destacable es que somos el importador de Moriwaki para España y Portugal. Únicamente, como todos ya tenéis una carpeta en la cual expongo un poco todas nuestras actividades, destacar todas las actividades que podemos hacer en cualquiera de estas. Os dejo con Josep Palà, que es el director del posgrado, que nos explicará un poco y profundizará en el mismo.
Vale. Bé, bona tarda igualment. Dono la benvinguda. Os doy la bienvenida. Yo, como soy el que me toca cerrar este acto y vosotros habéis venido a escuchar, ¿vale?, voy a intentar ser lo más rápido posible, ¿vale? A ver, muy rápidamente, mi pregunta, o sea, yo tengo que contestar a qué hace el señor Fuale aquí, ¿no? Es decir, tenemos un posgrado en marcha, es la cuarta edición que se hace, es un posgrado que está dividido en 5 módulos, los componentes principales de la moto, es decir, motor, dinámica, electricidad electrónica, por descontado el piloto con todo el tema del factor humano, y por descontado con el módulo de desarrollo de producto, porque una cosa es diseñar y otra luego es fabricar, ¿no? Son dos cosas muy diferentes y era un módulo que nos interesaba mucho ponerlo aquí, más que nada porque las empresas no solamente diseñan, sino que también fabrican, ¿no? Entonces, como he dicho, es la cuarta edición. En cada una de las ediciones que hemos ido haciendo nos ha interesado siempre traer a alguien de renombre. En alguna edición, en la segunda, por ejemplo, conseguimos traer a Miguel Galucci, diseñador de la Ducati Monster, dentro de lo que es el módulo de factor humano. Y en esta edición nos pareció muy interesante que dentro del módulo de dinámica, para cerrar este módulo, ¿vale?, viniera una persona de referencia. Creo que en el mundo hay 2 o 3 personas de referencia y creo que tenemos la suerte de tener una hoy aquí. De hecho, es la única que tiene un libro de referencia en castellano escrito, que, por cierto, no es que me salga la vena comercial, pero también lo tenéis aquí, si queréis echar una ojeada, ¿vale? Entonces, decir que un poco como respuesta a intentar traer una persona de referencia dentro del marco de lo que es el posgrado Mototec, pues esta vez hemos conseguido que venga el señor Fuale, ¿no? Como he dicho, es la cuarta edición, es modular, es un posgrado que durante el 2011 se ha hecho el módulo número 1 y el módulo número 2, y que ahora, digamos, va a empezar el 3 de febrero, el 1 de febrero, pero el próximo miércoles, el primer miércoles de febrero, lo que son los módulos 3, 4 y 5, ¿vale? La idea es acabarlo, no le va a acabar tan cara, ¿vale? No le va a acabar tan cara. Le vamos a dar los títulos, ¿vale?, de los que han hecho los módulos 1 y 2, y ya está. Entonces, no me queda nada más por decir, solo invitaros también a que si alguien está interesado en el posgrado, todavía hay alguna matrícula abierta, y dar la palabra al señor Fuale. La idea de hoy de la conferencia es que, por favor, aparte de que el señor Fuale esté hablando y nos explique toda su vida dentro del diseño de la motocicleta, que sea una conferencia abierta. Creo que todos tenemos muchas dudas, muchas consultas, muchas preguntas sobre según qué cuestiones del mundo, sobre todo de la moto y en especial de lo que es la dinámica, bien sea motor de combustión, bien sea de moto eléctrica, que es el futuro. Y creo que la conferencia va a ser rica en la medida de que nosotros vayamos haciendo cuestiones, y ese señor Fuale nos las pueda contestar. No me enrollo más, doy la bienvenida a todos, doy la bienvenida al señor Fuale, welcome again, ¿vale?
First, I'd like to apologize for the fact that this will have to be in English. I speak a little Spanish, but not enough to do a talk like this. Now, normally when I do a presentation, it's on a technical subject. This is the first time I've done it talking about my own experiences or talking about myself, so I didn't quite know how to go about this. So what I've done, I collected a load of photographs and made some slides roughly in chronological order, and I thought I'll go through some of them. There'll be some interesting things, and I'll talk about why things were designed and why I designed them that way, and we'll see how it goes. Well, I welcome any questions on any of it. So if we've got the slide on now, it was only when I was preparing this, I'd never thought of it before, I realized that it's 52 years since I first started riding a motorcycle. A long time, but I think there's some people here that maybe have been doing a little bit longer. I still do. This is my father, so I think I've got him to blame for everything that followed, as you can see. When I was a small boy, I grew up wanting to race cars with people like Fangio and Stirling Moss, my heroes then. And somewhere along the way, and I've got no recollection of the conscious decision, I ended up racing motorcycles. I remember the first race, but I don't remember the decision to race motorcycles instead of cars. I'm probably a little bit different from any others you might get to talk about their experience with motorcycles, because I've never followed a regular career path in that line. For example, I haven't ever worked directly for a regular motorcycle factory. In the beginning, my experience with motorcycles was purely for my own racing, but then I got interested in the subject from a technical point of view, from an engineering scientific point of view, and I put a lot of time into trying to understand why motorcycles behaved the way which they did. Because at the time that I started, there was virtually zero literature on the subject. Even now it's hard to find any that's got any practical relevance. There is some of that, but it's not a great deal. When I was studying and graduated, I just had a regular job outside of motorcycles, and it never entered my head at that time, or I never had any plans that I'd make a career of working with motorcycles. It was something I always expected just to be a hobby, but sometimes life doesn't work out the way in which we expect it to. Sometimes it's better. I've had a lot of fun. Okay, so when I was about 15 or 16, I decided to go racing, and so I built my own race bike, combining an engine and frame from something else. At that time, what was called the Norton Featherbed frame had a mystical reputation for handling, and everybody thought that if you just had a Norton frame, didn't matter what suspension or engine you put in it, you'd have a great handling bike. So I managed to find a Norton Featherbed frame, which I put a matchless engine in, and that formed my first race bike. And my workshop at the time was I lived in Australia, but I was born in England, and my family moved out to Australia when I was about 8 years old, and my workshop was this wooden box that was made to take our furniture out to Australia. So you can imagine it was very small. In addition to that, I had a small lathe, a milling machine, a dynamometer, all in a little wooden box. I had no success with that. Originally, I thought when I started racing that I was going to go out and I was going to win immediately, because when I was riding with my friends on the road, I was always the fastest one, and I thought the same thing would apply, and I thought I'd build an extremely good racing bike. My first race was the biggest shock. I finished absolutely last. Just at the end of the race, the one who was first came by me on the finishing line on the right-hand side, and I started. I was very young and inexperienced, so I moved out of his way here only for the second man to come past me on the other side. So that was a lesson that was well learned. Anyway, shortly afterwards, I bought Greaves, which is an English-made machine. They're more well-known for building motocross bikes, or were. And they built a racing bike, and then I started to get some success. But being built the way I am, I couldn't just continue to, even though I was getting some success with this bike, I couldn't leave it as it was. So I had an idea that having a disc inlet valve was the way to get more power. So I had limited facilities, but I made some wooden patterns, and in the back garden of our house, I cast some new crankcases with a provision on here for disc inlet valve, but I still use the head and barrel for the greaves, although that was turned around the other way. But then, again, shortly after that, I've generally known in the motorcycling world for chassis and so forth. This is because I had a business making chassis commercially. But my real interest, certainly in the beginning, were more engines. And the chassis, this is the very first chassis that I built. And it was built simply to house this engine. This was a rather unusual two-stroke. It was a 125cc machine. It had a disc inlet valve like the previous one I showed, but the main difference with this one is that it's got a rotary exhaust valve in the head. Now, the significance of that is, with a normal two-stroke engine, you have the transfer ports, which let the fresh gas in, that's going to be burned in through some what are known as transfer ports. If this is the top of the piston, the transfer ports will let the gas in here, and the spark plug up here, etc. Then we have an exhaust port here. So we're having some gas coming in all around, and it all gets mixed up with the exhaust, and so it goes out the exhaust port because it actually closes after you've closed the transfer port, which let the fresh gas in. With this rotary valve engine, there's no exhaust port in the cylinder barrel, and also you've got relatively long gas paths which limit the maximum revs at which the engine will produce power. So with this, it was a rotary exhaust valve in the head, and that had a tube through it like so, which was like an exhaust port. And this rotated at a half the speed of the engine because it's got two openings. It didn't have a rotation. Now the whole bottom of the barrel could have transfer ports around it, increasing their width. So you get the same area that could actually be lower, which gives you more time for compression to take place, more volume to capture the charge. And also it's what's called a uniflow engine, that the flow is all in one direction. So the gas paths are short, so the potential RPM is higher. But because this is then rotating and can be geared to the crankshaft in any phase that you want, there's no need to shut this port after the transfer ports are shut. So you can achieve asymmetric timing on the exhaust port. So it's for all the customers in the back garden. Break up crankcases and things from old Triumph motorcycles and melt it down and make a cast on. Probably not great. Okay, that's just another view of the same one. I drove the valve with a little chain that came up through here. The chain for to take the power went in this case. Here. Now, because I'm very familiar with what I'm talking about, saying this for the benefit of those that aren't, a normal high-performance two-stroke exhaust system, something like that, and it's designed this way, these tapers reflect back waves, and the idea is that in this time between when the transfer is closed and when the exhaust port closes, that we've got some pulses coming back to prevent an excessive charge loss through there. And that's essentially what this converging section does. It sends back this pulse. This part tends to give a negative pulse to try and suck out quickly. Well, because I had asymmetric timing, I didn't need to ram this back in to the same extent that I did with that you would have to with a conventional piston-ported exhaust port. I reasoned that it would be simple for development if I didn't use that part of it, which is why it's just got an open megaphone, which would be considered fairly unusual for a two-stroke. anyway, it worked very well. It started immediately, which surprised me. I thought it took me a week to get far and be happy with it, or even if it might have probably banged and popped, because everybody told me it didn't work at all. Here's some of the components of it. That's the actual valve. These things here are some large bearings. This was the valve. These are the transfer ports. The receptor layer on the bottom. And this was the head valve. It's in through here, and the exhaust pipe fits on here. It also had twin spark plugs, rather than necessary. This is a view of the engine without the top end on it. You can see the disc in that valve here. I had very crude facilities for making this, because I was still only 17 or 18 years old, so I didn't have enough money to buy sophisticated machinery. Normally on a factory-made engine, you probably have some nice splines on the shaft here. The driving mechanism for the disc would be fitted to. I just welded some little keyway pieces onto the shaft and then hand filed the aluminium part so that it was a nice fit on there. But you can achieve anything with your department. You don't have to have fancy CNC equipment. Anyway, it went out and I won its first race on it. Oh, but one thing, coming back to the exhaust, one thing that was an incredible disadvantage for this, much more than you would think maybe just from discussing it, was the noise it made was absolutely incredible. The exhaust came up about here. And it was so painful riding it, I actually had to drive it, trying to get my head down to the side of the tank, because the noise. That was before the days that we generally used the earth protection, which is one of the reasons why I'm getting old is really the other reason. Okay. Now I'm skipping forward 12 years or so here, because it's on the same theme. I think it was something like 12 years later or something like that. It was when I then had a business making chassis, and I had a fairly well-equipped workshop. So I made a second engine with the rotary exhaust valve in the head, but this time, instead of making all of it, I just made the top end, and the bottom end was based on a racing Yamaha. For those in the know, it was a TZ250, 350 from that particular period. And so I just had to make the cylinder. The cylinder head. This time, instead of casting them, I machine them out of the solid. Not CNC, but still machining out of the solid. Anyway, everything I learned from the other one, which had worked very well from the beginning, I applied to this, and made a vastly improved version. The problem was, it was an absolute failure. If this had been the first engine I built, I would have said, oh yeah, everyone who said it wouldn't work was right. To this day, I have absolutely no reason and no idea why this was a complete failure. It took me 3 weeks, it's sitting here on a dynamometer. This was the actual power absorption unit dynamometer, which I made from a fluid clutch of an American car. It took me 3 weeks of development to get it to produce enough power to overcome its own internal friction. So then it would run as long as there was a starter motor driving it, it would pop and bang. And then I spent about 3 months on it and I got up to, I don't know, 12 horsepower or something. Silly figure. I still have absolutely no idea why this one didn't work. And the other one, which was not the improved version, worked so well. Life can be funny sometimes. This is just some parts. And here you can see the valve instead of just doing one cylinder head and two. These are timings. The pistons are going up and down at certain times. And this is part of the lower part. Well, the main part of the head, the part that went over the top, is just a cover. On the rotor, I used bearings just a very small amount larger than the cylinder. It was bigger than was necessary for strength, but the reason for it was that it was very simple to machine the housing for it, because I just had to then have the constant diameter bore through here, so I could bolt the cover and that together, put in a lathe with a boring bar, and just make one diameter, and then this would just drop in. Whereas with more sophisticated machining facilities, I probably would have used smaller diameter bearings here, and then I would have had a step in the diameter here. Okay, so getting back more time, as well as racing, I used to ride on the road all the time. I didn't have a car for many years. But one day I became the product owner of a flash-looking BMW, but it didn't take me long before I put on aluminium mudguards guards and tuned the engine, made some different leading forks for it and so forth, because I couldn't stop myself. I just had this urge to always try and make something that I thought was better. But with this bike, the modified version, this one, it was this rack on the back, which you might be able to see here, was very important for what followed. I started doing some initial investigation of how motorcycles steer, because in the early 1960s, I read a paper that had been written by a man called Wilson Jones, who was the chief engineer of the Royal Enfield motorbike factory. And he'd done some experiments trying with very crude instrumentation, a lot of it mechanical instrumentation, to actually measure countersteer. And when I read it, my first reaction was, that's crazy, we don't steer in the wrong direction. So immediately I went out and I got on a bike, and I tried to observe what I was doing to go around a corner. And I couldn't work out what it was, because I came to a corner and the bike went round it, and I could not detect what I was doing to make it do it. But I tried deliberately doing some counter-steering, doing this to the handlebars, and sure enough the bike would lean over. So I could see that counter-steering would make a bike lean over, but that wasn't the same thing as saying one had to counter-steer to make it lean over. And there didn't seem enough other explanation in the paper by Wilson Jones to satisfy my curiosity. And at the time, I think I was about 16 or something, I just started university, but in order, my parents couldn't afford to send me through university, so I got a job at the university in order to see the best place in order to fund my way through. And I was doing an electrical engineering degree, and I worked in the electrical engineering department at the university. So I was able to put together some instrumentation to try and see what was happening. So I connected up string to potentiometer, and I made a differential capacitor accelerometer, so I could get some idea of lean acceleration. And at that time, like they had in the department, there was a newfangled portable stereo tape recorder. It's portable, it's about this big. And that was what this rack was for. Because unknown to my boss and lecturers at the university, when nobody was looking, I would strap this massive tape recorder onto the back. And being stereo, it gave me two channels, so I could measure two things. Later I found that inadequate, and so I built a little multiplexer, which enabled me to record two channels on each of the stereo lights. So I had four data channels, and we just happened to have a four trace oscilloscope that we just acquired in the department, so I could look at my recorded data on this four channel oscilloscope. And I could see from that I was, even though I wasn't conscious of it, that I was actually counter-steering to some extent whenever I came up to a corner, because I put a little marker in the signal. I put a button on the handlebar, which I could just press, and I just put a little marker in the recording, so I knew when I was what stage I was in the recording process. And so, reading that paper, it'd be fair to say it changed my life because it put me on a quest of understanding dynamics. But then I could see what was happening, but I couldn't fully understand it. And being a sort of beginning engineering student, I've learned a little tiny bit of engineering mathematics. So I then wrote down what I thought was appropriate for the equations of motion of the process, and then found out something that was a very good lesson, is that when you want to analyze something like that, some complex problems, it's relatively easy to write down equations of motion. It's not always that easy to solve them. But we had a 40-channel analog computer department, and so I started using that to try and solve the equation, but it soon turned out, I got some information from it, but it soon turned out to be fairly inadequate. But then after a year or two, I changed jobs and had access to much larger computer. Firstly analog, and then we started using digital computers for simulation. And then I was able finally to get the answers of how a motorcycle steers and leans and so forth. And for those who were here in the previous talk this afternoon, you saw the results of some of that. That wasn't from the simulations I did back in the 60s, because back then there was no, when using a computer, we didn't have a screen or our own terminal. We wrote a program, you had cards punched by somebody else, you left a box of cards on your desk in the evening, and if your program had run successfully in the morning, you came back and you had a pile of paper full of numbers. If there was some bug in your program, you came back and there was a small pile that said you had a bug in the program. Correct. So it's a very slow, tedious process, but it was, it was just able to achieve something. So there's no any graphs, it was a question of plotting by hand, unlike the thing we saw this afternoon, which were done. But still based on the same thing that I developed back in the 60s. Okay. Whenever I could, I was always riding anything on two wheels I'd ride. I had an old motocross bike, I'd ride in trials, road racing, anything I could get. Working as I did just part time at university, I didn't earn, even though I paid for my tuition, I didn't really have enough money to go racing. So in the evening, I had another job, and I worked for this man who had a motorcycle shop, and I worked for him as a mechanic in the evening. Now, not only did that help fund my racing when I earned there, but it was absolutely invaluable experience, because I worked on a wide range of motorcycles, so I soon became very aware of which ones were designed badly from a maintenance point of view, which ones were designed well, which ones gave more trouble than another, and why did they give more trouble than another one, what design feature was so good in this one. So it was absolutely invaluable experience. But it was very funny when I started it the first night, because he said that he was going to pay me so much, which was a fairly low hourly rate, but I was only 17 or something like that. And so I accepted it. But the first repair job that he gave me, it was an electrical fault on this machine. And he had a mechanic who worked for it in the daytime. And this bike had been in for about 10 days, and they couldn't fix the problem. Well, my hobby before motorcycles was electronics, and I was studying electrical engineering, so the electric system on 1960s motorbikes was not very much of a challenge. So within 10 minutes I was able to find and cure the problem on that, and the owner of the shop was so impressed that he then said, oh, I'll pay you three times what we'd agreed before. So, so I think about this, as a kid of 16, I was earning the hourly rate of the average adult in Australia at that particular time, so that helped a lot. He was a great enthusiast. I'm sure he's dead now. He was old when I was 16. And this was the second chassis that I built. Now, for a while when I had the business making chassis, quite wrongly, I became known as someone who always made backbone chassis, or chassis with a large spine frame, which wasn't true because I made quite a lot like that, but I also made quite a lot using a triangulated design, as you can see here. This was exceptionally light. I think these tubes were probably about 16 millimeters diameter. I think these were about 13 millimeters diameter. So it was very, very light, but very stiff. An interesting design feature here is you can see I've got a very long headstock. The reason for that most motorcycles, you have a rear wheel here and then some sort of structure there. We have the headstock here, the forks are here, the sliders like this. This moves a certain amount, say that moves up to here, and on the vast majority of motorcycles, there's an awful lot of distance here between the fully compressed suspension, the top of the slider, and the bottom of the clamps that are under here. So I thought, well, it makes the fork more rigid if I lower that. But there's no point in lowering the top, I thought, because the length of the forks is more or less the same. This wasn't in my vision, heads up here, looking here. So there was no real incentive to lower the top. So what I did was just lower the bottom, in other words, make it longer, which also gave a wider base to take the forces back into the rest of it. It didn't really increase the weight, and it made the fork stiffer because it shortened this overhung part. So, there was a reason behind making that longer. This was the third frame. Now, all of these were built before I was actually working for a living with motorcycles. I just built for my own use. I was a bit obsessed with weight, and so I wanted to make things lighter. So again, this is a fully triangulated frame that I built for the BMW sort of picture earlier. This was a stark contrast with paddock facilities to today. This was quite typical. You just sort of had an open field next to the racetrack. It was very rare to have garages or anything like that, so came in a car, toolbox, a can of fuel, and bike. But also testing on racetracks was much harder to do, particularly where I lived in Australia then. The racetracks were 700 miles away, so I used to have to do my testing on public roads, which is what this is. One day it was funny because we were loading the bike back onto the trailer and the police came around and said something about, we've been after you for about 3 weeks. Then in 1971, I read in one of the motorcycle magazines that the International 6 Days Trial, which is now called the International 6 Days Enduro, was to be in the Isle of Man. Now, I don't know how familiar you are with this event, but it's 6 days of enduro, which is sometimes known as the Olympics of motorcycling. It's a pretty tough competition. And it's normally held in different countries every year. Well, I always had an ambition to race in the road races in the Isle of Man. And in 1961, the International 6 Days Trial was going to be in the Isle of Man, so I thought, well, this is a unique opportunity to be able to do both, because as well as road racing, I was also very interested in enduros. So as soon as I read that, I decided that I was going to leave Australia, move back to England, to do the two in the Isle of Man. I didn't expect to be away from Australia for this length of time. So I bought two bikes to do that. One was an Aramaki, which is an Italian single-cylinder machine, which you'll be seeing. And it didn't arrive in time for the road racing. Well, just with a couple of days to spare, a racing dealer and enthusiast in England called Jeff Monty lent me this Bultaco to take over. So my first Isle of Man was done on a Bultaco instead of an Aramaki. Fortunately, the ship arrived in time for the bike for the International 6 Days Trial. And then, after doing those two events, when I went to England, I thought I had enough money saved up that I could do the racing and it would last me a year if I was careful with it. Well, after I'd finished in the Isle of Man, I had absolutely nothing left at all. It was all gone, the tyres and everything else. So I was looking for a job, so I went back to see the man who lent me this bike, to see if he had a job for me as a mechanic while I looked around for what I call a proper job as an engineer. And he said that he didn't, but he said, go to John Surtees' factory up the road. I think they're looking for somebody. So I went up there and I saw another woman in the office, and she said, oh, yeah, we're looking for somebody to operate a milling machine. So I said, oh, I can do that. And then before we arranged anything, we were standing in the foyer. John Surtees, for those who aren't familiar with the name, Surtees, here on the bike here, is the only man to have ever won the World Championship in motorcycles and the Formula One World Championship in cars. And he had a factory making race cars. He had his own team and made the Formula One cars, but it was Formula 2 at the time and Formula 5000. And Mike Haywood, who probably knows, extremely good motorcycle racer, had turned to racing cars, and he was the contracted driver. So Surtees came walking down the steps and just said to me, interrupted conversation with the woman talking about operating the machine, and said, I'll come back and see you next Thursday. So I went back next Thursday, and he said, how would you like to be the works manager? I thought, this is very strange, because we haven't even talked about it. Well, I never embarrassed him by asking, but I'm sure it was the man who lent me this bike had called up ahead of my visit and suggested. So for a while I worked in Formula One overseeing the construction of the cars at the Surtees factory. But it was quite funny because the week after the first week that I was there, the weekend, there was going to be a Formula One race, and the Surtees came and gave me some tickets and said, I'll see you at the race. I said, oh, I'm racing a motorbike that weekend, I can't go. And he said, I really expect sort of dedication. I'll leave it up to your good sense as to whether you, could continue on the motorbike racing or come along to the Formula One event. Well, I went for 2 weeks. that was my whole purpose of moving from Australia to England, so not to race on the motorbike when I had the chance. It seemed rather silly. I've never come across anybody who was as driven as he was. Howard, on the other hand, was an extremely nice man, but he was very difficult to work for. Nobody lasted 6 months there. Anyway, right at that time, after my Aramaki had arrived, the chassis that was on it when I bought it, I didn't like the design of it, and it was rather heavy. So I decided that for the Isle of Man race the next year, I'd build a new chassis for it. And basically, this was it, which was much, much lighter than the other one. That would have been for 1990.
before, right? So there's some changes. This is 1974 version in the pictures there. But this, I was just living in a single rented room at that time, and I built this frame in my bedroom. I had to wait for the landlady to leave before I could carry in the oxygen and the second in bottles. She never did know what went on in that room. But I've no recollection of what I used for a jig to align it, but that's something I've always been very critical with, so I must have done something, but I can't remember what it was. Anyway, when I lived in Australia, before I left, I always had very good, interesting jobs, with a lot of technical content. And when I moved to England, and was looking around for an engineering job, I found it very, very difficult, because I suppose for my age, I got to perhaps a reasonable level of responsibility in the jobs that I had. When I went to England, potential employers, when they read my CV, they said, well, you're too young, you couldn't possibly have done all these things. And so it was very difficult to get a job. I did get a job in London. I hated travelling to London every day. That was making mathematical models for predicting wind forces on oil drilling rigs that started putting in the North Sea. The de facto British ice racing team thought that they could improve it by having some rear suspension, particularly on the corners. And I studied some videos, and they get up to, with the spikes on the tyres, they have spikes on the tyres, I think about 50 millimetres, sharpened to an absolute point. And so they can get tremendous grip, much more than you do on tyres. And measuring lean angles from a video, it looked like they were getting 2, maybe 3 G cornering acceleration, which means you're lent over so much like that. And I said, well, putting suspension on isn't going to help much, because the bike's going to do this, you're not actually applying much force in the direction of it. But they insisted they wanted to try it anyway. But they weren't that interested in having suspension in a straight line. So what I did with this, I thought, well, if I have it so that there's a normal sort of amount of suspension when it's just sitting there, when you're cornering at the 2, 2.5 G or whatever, that extra load is just going to compress the suspension and it'll be solid anyway. So I thought, well, if I put a much stronger spring on, then that's not going to help too much either, because then it's going to be getting closer to not having any suspension at all. So what I did, I used a relatively soft spring, but with a tremendous amount of preload on. So when it was just sitting there, the weight of the rocket or going down the straight, it was just as if it was solid. It was fully, the suspension was fully extended. But then when you leant over and applied that extra load, that would then be enough to overcome the preload, and then it would be into the relatively soft frame. But I know they took it to Sweden for a test, and I thought, I never heard any more about it, and I thought that was the end of it, and it wasn't used. It was only in the last 2 or 3 years I found out that it had actually been used up until about 1975, I think, when somebody sent me this very poor photo there. I noticed that it put a conventional speedway type of seat on it. I'd made this all in composite one, because I thought it allowed the rider to move about a bit, because it's one thing that they don't want to do this type of riding. But also, it was very smooth. And I thought that, because with something that is like this, you've got all sorts of tubes and carburetors and everything to knock your knees on and generally get caught about. And I thought the smooth surface of it might be an advantage. Whether it was or whether it wasn't, whether it got lost before he'd got it, I have no idea. These are just an example of other chassis that were done. This one came to Spain. motorbike and Moto Guzzi. Moto Guzzi themselves, of course, later came out of the chassis very, very similar to that, but I won't go into that story. But this was another one that somebody, this man, wanted to resurrect the Rudge name. He was using a Meswaite Speedway engine in it, when I put the prototype for it, I think that's as far as it was. But in addition to doing work for customers, I was still doing things myself. I was still doing various investigations and things. But for my own racing gear, Mackie, which if you remember the pictures before, it was an air-cooled engine, but it was also two valves and it was air-cooled, and it's push-rod operated. So I made a four-valve head for it, which was relatively new in motorbikes, except for racing Hondas at that time. And I also made it water cooled. But everything with this was machined over to the solid. But again, before CNC, so it was all machined over to the solid. And to perform very well. In addition to building ordinary motorcycles, I was once asked to build a couple of sidecars. Racing sidecars. Now, I've never been able to drive a sidecar properly. Any attempt I made always ended up with going into a wall or a hedge. But I think it was probably an advantage because I was able to approach the design of it without any preconceived ideas or tunnel vision. So, because I had some experience with car dynamics, and this was done in a short period of time when the regulations were quite free on the type of suspension you can have. So since that time, they've tightened up on them. So you could use a lot of car techniques in it, and that's basically what I did. But also the suspension was designed, the sidecar wheel wasn't suspended, so I knew that in roll, it would always pivot about this point. So it was relatively easy to design the suspension so that whatever roll angle will be, the wheel stay vertical on the ground, which enabled you to use wider, flatter tyres than you might otherwise get. I built two of these, they both won various championships. There's some more detail of it. It's the same. I kept the chrome trail the same in all three cases. Now, where the BMW was a very good machine to do this was, I think you can see here, that the axle is offset from the centre of the forks. Now, there's always some offset in the fork clamps as well. I need the picture of the standard bike for that. But the offset in the clamps was almost equal to this. It was about the same. So in the standard bike, which I can't remember exactly at 27 degrees right angle or whatever, the steering axis here, you have the clamps here, the forks would come down here, and the wheel spindle was the same head as that. So we had these two distances were approximately the same. So we had an offset of the wheel spindle from the steering axis of this much. Well, because they were the same, if I turned one around the other way, for instance, just turn the forks around the other way, it meant that I could try the case where the steering axis went through the axle, or very close to it, which is that top case, and that worked out that in order to achieve that, I had a rated count of about 18 degrees, and then by turning this around and turning these around, I then had this back here. And to achieve the same rake, I was able to have it so that it was near vertical. I think it was about 2 degrees or something. So I was able to try these three different things fairly easily just by having this different bolt-on superstructure. So I did quite a lot of testing, particularly with it in this guise, because all the testing was done on the public roads. This one, I didn't do very much testing on, because on the public road, this has got a twin leading shoe front brake, which means it doesn't stop very well backwards, it stops well forwards. But by turning everything around, in this case, it turned the twin leading shoe brake into a twin trailing shoe brake, and it just wasn't safe enough to do very much riding on the road. But it still proved the point of, it gave me some data, some investigations I was doing on that. I also did other experiments, like this one here. I had the idea, it seemed to me, why do we hold our hands like this? And if you let your arms go loose and bring them up, that's where they are. So I thought, well, it's got to be more comfortable if that's where it's going to happen. And it turned, but I was a little bit worried. I didn't know whether, this, you can do that very easily. I didn't know how this was going to work, but it feels very, very natural. But one thing I did find is that while this angle isn't very critical, because after all we've gone from here to there, so a little bit of variation difference, but what turned out to be very, very critical for each rider is this forward angle, because you'd have to bend your wrist like this if it was wrong. So a taller rider, if arms coming from here, tilting further forward, a shorter. But some of these experiments were leading up to a bike that I've been meaning to do for 20 years or so. I laid the basic specification down when I was a kid still. And well, this was just a prototype of the different front suspension that I wanted to use on the thing. Just a picture of Jeremy's testing play. That was all leading up to building this, which was, despite its large, heavy appearance, was very, very light. Because one of the things that these different types of suspension like this compared to all the headstock mounted forks is that the forces that you're feeding back into the chassis are much, much less, because you've got much less leverage on it. With a normal bike here, we've got the headstock, we've got the long forks. We're applying braking forces, for example, down here. So the actual forces on the bearings up here are quite high. And then we've got to provide a structure that's pretty stiff to resist the bending of this headstock. If we start taking the forces out here and here, for example, then these forces are reduced tremendously compared to what these are. So if we're feeding very low forces into the chassis itself would be built much more. So it was a one-piece body, and here you can see one of the advantages also about the central handlebars. It made it have to lift off much easier. But there's a tremendous amount of storage space in this. The seat would lift forward, and all this is available for dry and close storage. The fuel tank was under the seat. I've got a picture of that body. On the front here, there was a lift-up panel that was lockable, where there was even more luggage space. And that was deliberately made big enough to put a full-face helmet in. And if you've ever tried to make a box or anything, put a full-face helmet in, you know it takes a lot of room. They're quite big. Okay, this was a follow-on from that, what I call the QL this one was meant as a practical bike that was, I didn't see that there had to be a difference between a touring bike and a sports bike. I thought you could build one that did both, one good handling, lightweight, that also had a lot of luggage space that you could, an aerodynamics that gave good fuel consumption and good rider protection. Whereas this bike was what I call the flash bike. It's a bike to be seen on, but much less practical. But it used the same type of front suspension and so forth. But this was built back in the 1985. Oh, so Buell didn't invent the rim disc. But neither did I. The idea didn't happen. This was the QL without the body on, and I think you can see the minimalist construction that this type of front suspension allowed. Basically, it was two aluminium plates here, about 6.5 millimeters thick, that essentially used the engine as a big spacer, and it bolted the plates up to the engine and formed a very rigid but lightweight structure. And a good base on which to put other things. So this is under the seat. This was the fuel tanks and the batteries here. Now the bodywork mounted on just two mountings, which were held with wing nuts. Under the seat there was a mounting. On here there's like a little L piece, and in the body, which came down and it sat on there, I had a piece of foam fiberglassed in that was about 25 millimeters wide, so it was a very light piece of structure, but very rigid. And that, the vertical load was taken by sitting on the bottom of the L-shaped piece, so that there was no need to mount, to bolt it to support the vertical, downward vertical load. But to stop it lifting up and moving side to side on this piece, which is very thin sheet metal, about 1.5 millimeters thick, it was this triangulated piece that was welded in nut. Now, on the actual body in this bulkhead with the foam piece in, there was just a thumb screw that went in, so when the body went down, you just put that in and just tightened it up. And in this area, it was located in every direction. And then there was another cross piece here, again, with a nut inside the body, which just access to put it all out on there. So it was very, very easy and quick, but an extremely rigid mounting. This was essentially the sort of under the skin of one of these. And before making the main bodywork for the other one, I had access to a 6-scale wind tunnel at a university, and so I made a 6-scale model and did some wind tunnel tests, which indicated I managed to get a 6-scale model of a standard BMW also, and I didn't think it would be very accurate to take any drag measurements directly from that and try and get CD values that I could correlate with a real full-size machine. But I thought it was probably fairly indicative if I had a machine of the same scale that was the standard one, and I just did a direct comparison between them. And doing the direct comparison, it showed that the Q-nail had about 65% of the drag of the standard RMITS. Oh, and this was its first maiden voyage. I rode over to Milan in the middle of winter, and it was a pretty arduous trip, but it survived okay. But in Milan, going through peak hour traffic at one time, I kept having to stop because people would just run out of the bike. Here a lot of people at the bus stop and just have their photo taken. bike. But it was incredible. It was very dangerous riding it coming out of Milan. It was pouring with rain. It was the evening traffic hour. And bus drivers and people in the Fiat 500s, everybody was just, they didn't care of the danger of Milo just coming over to look at it. It was incredible. But that's the Italians. Okay, then in 1983-84, I wrote the first book on chassis design, because there'd been one or two books written about race car design at that time, and there was nothing really around for motorcycles, so I thought that there ought to be, so I wrote the book, and it was based, the sort of idea for what to cover, and the themes of it were based to a large extent on the car one. But it wasn't really the book that I wanted, because it was being published with a regular publisher, and the publisher dictated how big it was going to be, and the illustrations and so on and so forth. But it was it sold a lot, and it was very successful, but it wasn't quite what I wanted to write. And then I started slowing down on, I came pretty close to the centre of the sprocket, and it gave minimum variation in the chain tension. I've built so many different chassis types that I just don't remember them all. One day somebody sent me this article on BMW that I had built an endurance race in BMW. I had absolutely no recollection of it at all. First of all, he sent me an email and said that he'd seen an article about it, and I said, I didn't build any. And then he sent me this, and you can always recognise your own work. When I studied the pitch, I thought, yeah, I definitely did. And it took a long time before I could get any recollection of it, but we did do an awful lot. And then, in the early 80s, I put to the test some ideas that I've been harbouring ever since I've been a teenager. I could never understand why we had the forks laid back at an angle of, well, for a long time it was around about 27, because gradually got steeper on most bikes. I could never understand why we had to lay the forks back like that, because it seemed to me that from a geometrical point of view there were disadvantages with it. But I've been warned, I don't know if the name Phil Irving means anything to you, but he was a very famous Australian motorcycle designer. He's credited with designing the Vincent Leigh twins, involved with Velocette and AGS. It was very experienced. Anyway, when I was quite young, I was fortunate enough to meet him, and I asked him why his book on motorcycle engineering, he more or less indicated that if you parted from departed from the magic angle of 27 degrees, all sorts of bad things would happen. And he just put me down and more or less is saying, oh, you know, you're just a kid, what do you know, go away with that sort of thing. So anyway, it took me a long time to get around to testing it. And, well, basically what I theorised at the beginning seemed to be borne out in the test. In this particular case, I've got a superstructure here at one basis, and there was increasing problems with litigation and things like that. People becoming more aware of the dangers to a business doing that were increasing. So I started to do work more with consulting, helping race teams with suspension setup, started doing seminars and so forth. And then with the advent of the internet, I started getting a lot of feedback about people asking me to do a new book and so forth. So in 2002, I wrote a new book, and with the technology that was available at this time, it was very easy to self-publish. So then I was able to write the book when I wanted to, and wasn't limited as I was back in 1984. That's also available in Spanish, and if anyone wants to buy any, I've got a number here. So now most of my time I do some consulting for race teams or factories, do seminars on road bike dynamics, and also develop some suspension software. It's just an example of one of the things I did for one race team once. They wanted to measure the stiffness of their chassis, but they were doing it all wrong. They were doing it in a way which was impossible for them to separate out the torsional stiffness from the lateral stiffness. So I developed some methods for them to show them how to separate out the different effects. This is one way to measure the lateral stiffness. There's a cable here, fully, you can't see it here, but there's a plate which we put now weights on and measure the deflection. But so it's a very flat table, which is very, very deep, and so it's very, very rigid, so it maintains its dimensions. And they have a grid of drilled and tapped holes 25 millimeters apart over the whole surface. So it's a great reference plate on which to build chassis and so forth, and it's very easy to do some jigging. So this is the rear part of the frame, which I jigged on there, you can see, with absolutely, but in a very rigid way, very simple mounting points, what I had for the support of seat tubes. So it's basically just locked up, but then dimension, that's pretty much it. If anyone's interested in, more pictures of some of the stuff I've done, that's my website. And, if anyone's interested, I've got plenty of copies of the chassis book at a lower price, and that's the commercial. But also on my website, there's some suspension setup software and things as well. Any questions?
Chassis made of plastic, injected plastic, using let's say high-tech plastic materials?
It wouldn't surprise me if on some of the new designs of electric bikes that are coming along, if somebody didn't try it on that. I think they're probably the type of bike that two things. One, the designers might be more inclined to try it because generally they're most of the people who are designing electric bikes are fairly new to it, and they don't have the tunnel vision of 100 years of history. But also the customers, particularly the first adopters for the electric bikes, are going to be much more open-minded than looking at other things. I think for something like, if you try now and build a sports bike with it, nobody would buy it. It probably could possibly be the best thing in the world. But I don't very much. Oh, a bit better. Okay. Is it on?
Yeah.
Is it on? Okay. I'm used to using a microphone that moves around with me. I always forget to hold these in the right place. So I think that the purchases of those early adopters would certainly be more open minded to that. But I think traditional motorcycle riders, it would probably take at least a decade of seeing it being used on something. Well, they'd want to see Rossi or somebody else using it on the track beforehand. It's probably going to be a long time before you get that.
Have you ever attempted to design a frame in plastic? Or?
No, I haven't. Aside.
I've been adjusted with the knowledge of motorcycles. I think you know, some of the wrong people have been making design decisions there. But, you know, that's just looking at it from the outside.
Thank you.
I want a discussion with Mr. Antonio Bobas and so on. And what do you think about the future of the new kind of cross dimensions at the University of Minnesota?
Well, one thing was a lot of these alternatives is I did some years before, and he actually went along to the BMW factory with a K100 converted to what's now the dual Libra system. They said, no, we're not interested in this. But a couple of months after his patents ran out, they announced the Duo Libra. So yeah, they seem to be the only. But then now, of course, on their ultra sports bikes, they're not using that system. They've got the telescopic forks. So I think it would be a very hard thing to see much of a change. We saw their market as being a consumer market, but the problem with that is it was too expensive. And the batteries are responsible for that, half the cost is batteries. It is the trouble with battery vehicles at the moment, batteries are just so expensive. And then the other thing that made it expensive was that the thing that was produced had not been designed for production. Basically, it was the people who developed it then put their final development into production. And so it needed some proper production engineers to go over it first and work out how to make it with the same quality but much cheaper than would have been possible. But I mean, their niche market now is things like police forces, security firms, plant managers, park rangers. Oh, they make a golf model and a off-road model. And they've realised that the consumer market is very low. But when did the world realise there was a financial crisis? I think it was September in 2009? Was it 2010? When all of a sudden everything just went like that. Their consumer sales just stopped when that happened. It was amazing. They just stop. They didn't go down 10% or 50%. They just died. But the corporate market, the travel market, and things has continued pretty much for them. But the reason that they never made any money, that in some ways was what I regard as sort of the optimum chassis. This is a swinging arm here. And you've got the steering head here. And if we look in plan view, we've got this. If we put a couple of tubes like that down each side, then we triangulated it and hold that way, and then if we like that, then triangulated this way. So it's a very efficient design. There's not very many bikes you can do it for. I was able to do it on a Rotax, but this is a fairly long tube, and essentially I made it.
And we worked in the development of the bike from Sequoia. What were the main tricky issues you found in that development? About the it was more important than in a traditional bike to protect the components or something?
Batteries and batteries with an electric bike.
Yeah.
That's the big problem today. The chassis that I did for you, you probably didn't get a good view of it there, yeah. Was with the two plates, and then the front forks were like the Hossack one with two links, which were two plates also. Part of the reason for that was because of the simplicity for manufacturing prototype. Also that the industrial design people wanted a form of construction which they could make look different and futuristic, which they were able to do within that concept. But I mean, from a chassis point of view, it was a relatively low. They weren't aiming for a super high performance. They were aiming for a commuter type machine, and so there were no real problems from the point of view of developing it to have good enough handling.
Yeah,
that's it. Really, I mean, I think anyone that's doing electric bikes. But yeah, particularly on, you know, a big sports electric bike, packaging the batteries is a big problem.
Yeah.
As is the weight. I mean, they're very, very heavy bikes. I mean, mm-hmm. in park
Okay. Thanks.
Okay, then my question to everybody here. At the beginning, I said.
Vamos a dar por concluido. Buenas tardes, ha llegado el WhatsApp.